you so much all for coming. This is a rare treat to bring all these artworks together. So we are just so lucky to have Lorraine's beautiful works and Eloise's and Ross's amazing sculptures. And Janine's going to speak her own poem later. So we are really blessed to have that. So the main reason for us being here really though is Nerida's exquisite pain and also her vast knowledge of all these amazing greats. So you'll learn so much about all these incredible composers as well along the way. So what I'd like you to do is to have a bit of a think to get the connections between the artwork and the poetry and the music, because there are links of majesty and lyricism and delicacy and renewal and cold and hot and light and shade. So if you can just sort of let it wash over you and see the links between all of them. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Nerida. Thank you.
thank you. There's familiar faces that I can see in the crowd, and there's new faces. So welcome to you all, and thank you for coming out and listening to this beautiful music. That was Johann Sebastian's Bach, and he's one of his many, many preludes and fugues, and it's just a wonderful place to be able to present his music, because he was all about the church, and it's a beautiful building that we are able to have the concert in, and heavenly acoustics, so I'm very, very grateful for that. Okay, so we're going to move on to some Mozart now. I've been looking at the artwork and thinking of like connections with Mozart, and I'm really struggling because his music was just all in his head. It would come out perfectly composed, so it's really hard to sort of, I mean, he was influenced by Bach and the other composers around, but as we go through the composers, the influences are more sort of concrete. But with Mozart, I'm really, really struggling. So I'm interested to sort of hear from you afterwards, sort of like if you've been able to draw any threads with the architecture of the building or with the artwork. I think he's very classic. So maybe that's it. It's a classic architecture. And by classic, I mean balanced and harmonious. So we're going to listen to his sonata in C major. The first movement will be Like an Old Friend. You'll recognise it straight away. The second movement is beautiful and lyrical, and it gave me the inspiration to invite my good friend Dale to come and sing an aria from The Marriage of Figaro afterwards. And the third movement is a playful rondo. It's just Mozart, exquisite, just Mozart being playful, and that's it's a joy to play, so enjoy. Thank you.
let Dale introduce the artwork she's going to sing.
So this aria is called Voi che sapete, and it's about love. It's about what he's saying in this song is that the thing of love of when you've got hot and cold and when your heart's beating and is it really love? And so what he's saying is that you who know who love is, really you know what love is, tell me if that's what's in my heart. So he's pouring out everything, all his feelings and saying, okay, you be the judge, is that really love or not? So that's the theme of the song.
We have the poem of Pinsuki by Janine Johnson, and what we're going to do is we're going to pair that with the Beethoven second movement from the Tempest Sonata. So there's some reasons why we're doing that. Some of you may know what Pinsuki is, but it was new to me, and it's all about the Japanese art of pot mending. And the artisan would gather together the pieces of the pot and mend them with gold leaf. And the resulting object would be more beautiful in its imperfect state than it was in its perfect form. And Janine and I share the same prayer group at Wesley College, and she'd recently had this poem published in a book, and she read it out, and I need to have that poem with this sonata. And the reason being is that it just fits really, really well with where Beethoven was at when he composed the Tempest Sonata. And we're not hearing the whole sonata, we're just hearing the second movement. And this poem is fantastic for the second movement because he's regenerating himself in this movement. The Tempest Sonata was written when he was age 32, so he's still a young and vital man. And he's had deafness for about 6 years now. He's tried many remedies, but none of them have worked. So he's at the point of despair. He's quite the broken man. And we know this because he would go to a place called Helgenstadt, which was in the countryside, and he would go there in the summertime and enjoy all the delights of nature. And here, this piece is very, very obvious and easy to make the links with the artwork that we have, that you walk past the beautiful lilies and the primulas and the blue orchids. He would have been walking amongst nature and looking at these beautiful sights and gaining solace and relief from his infirmity by what he could see. To really get a clear idea of where he was at, when he was at Helgenstadt, he wrote a very famous letter to his brothers, and that then became known as the Helgenstadt Testament. And if you've got a program, I've got lots of detailed notes about the music, but I've got a quote that I want to share with you that comes from this Helgenstadt Testament. Speak louder, shout, for I am deaf. How could I possibly admit infirmity in the one sense which ought to be more perfect in me than others? A sense which I once possessed in the highest perfection, a perfection such as few in my profession enjoyed or ever have enjoyed. I don't think I can paraphrase that. I think that just sums Beethoven's mood and where he was at when he wrote the Tempest Sonata. Now, it's good to understand the first movement. It's a very stormy, demonic piece of work. We're not hearing that today, but essentially he pulls himself to bits. He's dealing with the argument of, like, do I live on with my infirmity or do I commit suicide? Now, he's a devout Catholic man, so for him suicide would be the mortal damnation. So it's a very dramatic debate that he's having with himself. And at the final moment, he turns himself around and says, no, I'm going to live. And so the second movement that we're going to listen to is him sort of gathering himself together. And this is where the art of the kintsugi pot making that I thought came in so well. So I would like to invite Janine to come and share her work with us.
Kintsugi, a broken bowl, fractured fragments scattered. He gathers them up, pieces chipped and ugly. The bowl, like a life, wounded and shattered, fragile and faulty, no longer lovely. The master craftsman uses care and skill. His eyes see beyond the imperfection. He applies lacquer with gold powder and will give this delicate bowl resurrection. Its cracks are revealed so that all can see his healing seams illuminate the flaws. These golden repairs add new beauty. A treasured bowl is broken no more. He will mend the wounds with lines of gold. Celebrate renewal, precious to behold. Thank you. out.
I can tell you all listening really, really well, so I appreciate that a lot. We're going to move on to the Debussy, and this is called Clair de Lune, and the Francophones amongst us will know exactly what that means, moonlight. So we've gone from the countryside that was bathed in the golden sunlight to the silvery moonlight of Debussy's Clair de Lune. He's a composer that has influence from like Bach, Beethoven, Mozart, Stravinsky, lots and lots of musicians. But the thing that makes him different for me is that he looked at poets and painters for inspiration as well. And in this particular piece, it's a study on what moonlight is. It's like half shadow and half light. So there's lots of subtleties and if I was going to sort of like use a metal, I would say it's silver, whereas the Beethoven we've just heard is a lovely warm golden sunshine feel. This is a silvery moonlight piece.
Thank you.
to my last piece, it's gone so fast. I'm really delighted to have Neil videoing the event for us, so if anyone wants to have a copy of today's music, maybe leave your emails with Stephanie and Carol, who were up the front serving the champagne. We move on to the last piece, and we're going to listen to some Rachmaninoff. Now, with Rachmaninoff, it's 100% Russian, 100% proof Russian music. He wrote, I'd say, 99% of his music whilst he was living in Russia. He had to leave Russia in 1917 because of the revolution, and then he moved to America, and about age 40, had to establish himself all over again and became a concert pianist and was very, very famous on the American concert circuits, and was, I believe, instrumental in setting up the Juilliard Academy. So it's amazing what immigrants and refugees can bring to a country. Rachmaninoff brought many, many wealth and talents to the Americans. When you're listening to Rachmaninoff's music, you're listening to pure Russia, and their culture is a very, very old one. The melodies can predate Christianity. I don't know the origins of the melodies that he's used in this particular one, but they're very different and haunting and lush and beautiful. And the trick with this particular prelude is to see how many melodies that you can pick out, because they just come at different and unexpected levels. So I sort of think a guide for listening to this particular piece is to listen out for the melodies. Now, it's a military march, and its midsection is this lush, beautiful romance. And I thought of dedicating it to Ross's sculpture, although when he listened to it, he couldn't find anything at all related to his sculpture and this music. So not all links are felt by everyone. But I felt the connection with his warrior piece is that you have this harsh exterior. And then if you've actually been able to go behind the piece, you'll notice it's very, very smooth, and the surface is completely different on the inside. And that's what I felt with this prelude. You've got sort of the military march that's beginning the end, and then in the middle, this incredibly feminine romance. Thank you. Thank you so much. There's more refreshments. Please take time to talk with the artists. We've got Ross. I can't see Ross. Where is he? Ross is the creator of these amazing sculptures here. Lorraine is the artist of the lilies, the primulas, the swan and the peacock, and Eloise. She's just starting over there. She's done the other work, the blue orchid, the blue dream, the electric chair and life on Mars. Thank you so much for coming and supporting the arts. It's what we live for. We work to live, but we live for the arts, I feel. So I really appreciate everyone taking the time to come out and share with me and the artists. So thank you.
Thank you.